Hello friends, I am Srishti Jain and today we are going to do 5 questions of finance. Today the topics that we are going to cover are really important and that relate to the terminologies of insurance. Then we have a very good question on government e-marketplace. Then we'll move forward to the profitability index and NPV. And then we have a question on eNAM and the last one relates to the capital budgeting techniques. I hope that you're liking my video. Do subscribe to our channel for regular updates. Now starting with the first question for today. The first question says Mr. X started smoking after taking a life insurance from ABC Life Insurance Company. Which of the following concept is suitable to describe this situation? So we have 4 terminologies related to insurance. In the next slide, we will be discussing all these. So see, moral hazard means that suppose you have taken a life insurance and after taking the insurance, you're not taking care of yourself. Or if you take the example of a property, if you have taken a insurance against your property, then you are not taking adequate measures to safeguard that property. For example, you might think that there is no use to install the fire extinguishers in your property because you have an insurance against it. So this kind of thing is known as the moral hazard, that is not taking care of the property that have been insured. Then we have the adverse selection. Now, what does this mean? For example, let's talk about life insurance. So you are the insured and you are going to insurer to purchase a life insurance. You know that you are addicted to smoking, but you do not reveal this fact to the insurer because we know that higher the risk, higher would be the premium charged. So because of the concealment of this fact, the premium that the insurer will charge will be less than it should have been. So there is no actual risk exposure in this case. So therefore, this is the adverse selection. So basically, this is before taking the insurance, that is you are concealing the fact, whereas in moral hazard, after taking the insurance, you're not taking due care of yourself. So that will be the example of moral hazard. Then we have leveling. Now, what is leveling? Now, you all know that the premiums are somewhat constant. And what leveling is? Leveling is when the premiums are guaranteed to remain the same throughout the contract while the coverage increases. So, for example, we know that if a 20-year guy goes to buy an insurance and if a 60-year-old man goes to buy the insurance, then there is the high risk in case of 60-year-old man and therefore the premiums would be higher in case of this, and as compared to this, the premiums will be lower. So leveling is when you are setting a fixed premium throughout the contract. So what does that mean? If at the age of 20 you were supposed to give 100 rupees and if at the age of 60 you are supposed to give rupees 600. So leveling will mean that the premium is charged at suppose 350 rupees. So a 20-year-old lad and a 60-year-old man both will have to give 350 rupees throughout the contract. And this is known as leveling. And one related concept is of smoothing, wherein it is said that suppose we have determined this 350 and this will be at the age of 40 years. So from 20 to 40, there will be a surplus with the insurance company and that it will use to invest in some assets so as to compensate itself for the depletion in premiums in the 40 to 60 age. So this process is known as smoothing. Now the last term is of reinsurance. So it is a form of insurance which is purchased by insurance company. So isn't it interesting that we go to the insurance company to get ourselves insured and in return insurance company also goes to the reinsurance company to get itself insured. Now let's move back to the question to answer it. So the answer to this question will be moral hazard because here Mr. X has started smoking after taking a life insurance. That means he's not taking due care of himself just because he has got a life insurance. Now moving on to the next question for today. Now the question says, Government e-marketplace, also known as GeM, has signed a memorandum of understanding with Union Bank of India in October to provide array of services including transfer of funds through GeM pool accounts. Now we all know that by this statement, GeM is the main focus here. So which of the following marketplace is suitable to define GeM? So before answering this question, let's look at what exactly GeM means so that it is more beneficial for us to answer this question. Now with the help of this flowchart, let's understand what GeM is. Here the customer is the government officers who places the order. Then there is a service provider or the seller or the supplier. He manages received orders on the dashboard of GeM portal. Then he packs the items and manages on-time delivery to the buyer. Buyer is the government officers, as we have discussed. And then we have the customer, that is the government officers. They make the payment directly to the seller's bank account within the 10 days. So this is the process or the working of GeM. Now with this flowchart, it is now easier for us to understand through the definition that it is a one-stop portal to facilitate the online procurement of common goods and services required by various government departments, organizations or PSUs. So like the online marketplaces like Amazon, Flipkart, GeM is launched by the government 2 years back, wherein the customer is the government. So it is a type of B2G marketplace because it is the business to government transactions happening here. Public procurement forms a very important part of government activity, and reform in public procurement is one of the top priorities of the present government. And it is a very bold step of the government with the aim to transform the way in which procurement of goods and services is done by the government ministries and departments, PSUs, to have the transparency in the system. So the government officials can place the order on GeM and can compare the prices as well as we do on Amazon or Flipkart. Now let's move back to the question. So here, as we have discussed, that the customer is the government. So as a result, there is a B2G framework here. Now moving on to the next question for today. Profitability index technique is a variant of the NPV technique and therefore yields same accept reject decisions. Can the two techniques give contradictory decisions? If yes, then under which condition? So friends, let's see. We all know that PI is the variant of NPV technique, and PI is total present value of cash inflows divided by the total present value of cash outflows. On the other hand, NPV is present value of cash inflows minus present value of cash outflows. Both NPV and PI will give the same decision in case of the accept reject decisions. And we all know the reason behind this. The PI will be greater than 1 only for that project which has a positive NPV. So if NPV is positive, it will be greater than 1. And hence the project will be acceptable under both the techniques. On the other hand, if PI is equal to 1, then the NPV would also be 0. And if PI is less than 1, then NPV is negative. So under the accept reject decisions, the same decision will be conveyed by both the techniques. But however, there is a conflict between NPV and PI which may arise in case of evaluation of the mutually exclusive decisions. Now for example, there are two projects with us, and for example, the present value of cash outflows and present value of cash inflows are this. So in such a case, the NPV of the proposal comes out to be 60,000 and 55,000 respectively of both the projects, but the PI of these projects are 1.4 and 1.5, and you can calculate it by using these formulas. So the NPV says that accept the project 1, whereas PI says that accept project 2. So there is a contradiction between these two projects, and in such a case, NPP decision should be preferred unless there is a capital rationing. So if a firm has funds of 1,50,000 to invest, then it will result in an increase in shareholders' wealth to the extent of 60,000 against the project B, which will increase the wealth only by 55,000. So the better project obviously is one which adds more to the wealth of the shareholders, and as a result, NPV should be preferred over the PI technique. Now let's look at the options. The option says no, PI and NPV techniques always yield same result as PI is an invariant of NPV. So this is not true. Second is yes, PI and NPV techniques may yield different results in case of the projects having different lives. So this is also not true. They can give contradictory results in case of mutually exclusive projects. So this is true, and this is the answer. And the last one says that they may give contradictory result in case of the standalone projects, which is also not true. So option C is the correct answer. Now let's move on to the next question for today. Government of India through the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare has created an online trading platform for agricultural commodities. The market is helping in better price discovery and provide facilities for smooth marketing of the farmers' produce. Which of the following market has been created for this purpose and been talked about here? So the correct answer is eNAM, which is Electronic National Agriculture Market. Now let's have some understanding on what eNAM is in the next slide. Now as we all know that there are farmers and they cannot sell their produce directly to the end consumer. So as a result, APMCs are there in every state, and within state there are many APMCs. For example, there is Azadpur Mandi, or we say the Azadpur Market. So there are APMCs which help the farmers to sell their produce to the consumer. So there are middlemen, and as a result, they purchase from the farmers, and these APMCs, that is the Azadpur Market, then sell this to the ultimate consumer. But what is the problem in this? That they purchase the produce from farmers at a very throwaway prices and sell to the ultimate consumers at very high prices. So as a result, eNAM is the online electronic trading portal which networks the existing APMC mandis, or we say the market, to create a unified national market for agricultural commodities. So currently 585 APMCs are there in the network of eNAM. So everything will be online here, and therefore there will be transparency and no exploitation of the farmers as was there in the case of APMCs in the absence of eNAM. So this electronic trading platform has been created with an investment by the Government of India through the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. But this ministry has appointed Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium as the lead implementing agency of eNAM. And this consortium will operate and maintain the eNAM platform with the help of a strategic partner. So the second question for today is that who is the strategic partner currently who operate and maintain the eNAM platform along with SFAC. Now moving on to the next question for today. Various techniques are used for evaluating a proposal in capital budgeting. Some considers time value of money and some do not. Which of the following method of evaluation of capital budgeting proposals focuses on liquidity? So we all know that what IRR is, it is that rate of return which produces a zero NPV. And NPV on the other hand tells about the viability of a project by looking at the present value of cash inflows and outflows. So these both are the discounted method. The next we have is ARR, which is a kind of the traditional method of capital budgeting, and it focuses on the return on investment. So it basically tells the annual return of a project and it is expressed as a percentage of the net investment in the project. Whereas if you talk about the payback period, then it focuses on the liquidity, and it is also a kind of traditional method. So its main focus is on the capital recovery. For example, if there is a project for which the cash outflow is 1 lakh rupees and the cash inflows for 4 years is suppose 25,000, 50,000, 25,000 and again 50,000. So the payback period will suggest that 3 years is enough to recover the capital invested, and this is a kind of the liquidity measure. So in case a firm is having liquidity problems, then the payback period is a good method to adopt as it emphasizes the earlier cash inflows. So our answer here is option B, that is the payback period. So with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you like the session and questions. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. If you have any doubt related to any of the concept, then do ask me in the comment section, and also do not forget to answer the 2 questions that I have asked in the video. Thank you for watching the video.